I count on one thing. The same God who never fails will not fail me now. He won't fail me now in the waiting. The same God who's never late is working all things out. Working all things.
Super loud. Good evening, everybody. Rob, I know you were trying to tell me something, but I couldn't hear you earlier. Oh, that's what you're saying. I can't. My hearing's. All right. How's everybody doing? Pretty nice weather out there today. Yeah. Very, very good. Is there any announcements? Oh, Dr. Brown has an announcement, everyone. Matthew, be good now. You being good? Okay. Is that your dude?
Charlie trying to talk to you. Charlie trying to talk to you.
Okay.
He called on me.
He called on you.
We gotta sit down, Matthew.
Oh, good. That he's doing that.
No, I'm just saying it's not on that schedule, but April 9th is the next men's breakfast. They kicked us out of the church. We're going back to
the day of the Easter.
You didn't get it for that, did you? Okay, April 9th is the next men's breakfast with Dr. Brown.
Hello, everybody. I wanted to make sure I had a microphone.
Do we have enough
so
candy?
Can
is there enough candy?
You know, I am so blessed by the amount of donations. Yeah. I am thrilled for the kids. It's incredible. It was the tote out there was overflowing inside side box, and then there was more in there tonight. It was amazing.
So extra candy comes to me.
No extra.
No.
Candy is always welcome. We never have too much.
Not tomorrow.
No. We actually we need candy for the Easter egg hunt, but we also need candy for Sunday church. Our bucket is low, and so, you know, some of that overflow, we're going to put it in that stash, and, you know, looking forward to VBS even, we'll need candy for that, and this will be, like, the last holiday that we can get the fun-sized candy bars, but that's not why I'm up here, but I just wanted to say all that. We have a great need for Wednesday night children's church workers. We need nursery workers, toddler workers, elementary workers. I'm serving 4 out of 5 Wednesdays if it's a 5 Wednesday, and if we need training and all that, I just can't accommodate other people if they have needs that they have to fulfill. So we do have rotation needs. We also have fill-in needs in all areas. So please, 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 if you are wanting to help in that capacity. It's really quite easy because Wednesday night pretty chill, and then we don't go up until after worship, so it's usually about 45-ish minutes, depending on how long prayer goes and worship goes. It goes really fast. It really does. So see me, and I'll jump the schedule.
Well, the kids getting out of a headlock for 45 minutes.
Yeah, you can just headlock them.
So the surplus of candy can go, right?
Just give them candy and send them home.
Oh, we're good tonight. Yeah. We should be good tonight.
I give my kids, the grandkids, more yesterday, just give them chips and Girl Scout cookies. Aaron says, did you feed them? I said, yes, I fed them. What did they eat? Cheetos and Girl Scout cookies.
You're the man.
And Kool-Aid.
We've got some birthdays. We have a very special little man's third birthday today. Owen. Hey, Owen. Come here. Come here, baby. We're going to sing happy birthday to you. And then we have a very special young lady, Lael Havner, who is 18 years old today. And yesterday was Olivia's birthday. So we got 3 birthdays we got to sing for tonight, okay? So everybody get ready, put on your best voice. Here they go, Owen.
Happy birthday to you. Happy birthday.
I actually had cake right before I came. Birthday cake. Okay, is that all the announcements from the congregation? RSC Cares tomorrow night. I got the daycare. You guys remembering on Friday, there's the prayer thing.
Saturday.
Thank you. I know it was Rob Tapper, is that correct? I got to turn up. Yep, LifeNet, 5 o'clock. We're going to go and pray. Chris is feeling pretty good, right?
Yeah.
He's maybe going to come to that. Yep, that's awesome. Good. Yep, adult Sunday school class with Mr. Cannon, Holy Spirit class. This week we'll be receiving prophetic word. Women's Bible study on the 21st, 6:30, third floor of the youth room. 6 to 7, you guys see that, the guitar lessons with Joe Yukon on the 22nd. Yep, RSC Learning Community Meeting, that's Mr. Rooney's deal on the 24th, 27th. Young Adult Bible Study with Mackenzie. April 9th, Easter Egg Hunt. Sounds like the candies were good there. And Mr. Poland's Coronavirus Meeting on the 12th. Peru Construction Trip. I'll see Jason up there. And Pastor Mark. And there you go. Mega Week's coming up. We already got Mega Week on the calendar. Very, very good. How about praise reports? Are there any praise reports? Billy Martin.
We did a new reorg at work, and a lot of people was complaining about it, but I went from a negative area to being surrounded by four fellow believers and getting inspirational quotes on my desk every day.
So, all right.
You gotta be reading the whole company just for you. He loves you. Nice. Is there a
I want to share with you that Wyatt, one of Wyatt's cousins, he claimed to be an atheist, but he told Wyatt that he's not atheist anymore, you know, because we had the birthday thing for an early one, and that changed his whole thing.
Working in that, Lord's working in through Wyatt's situation.
My sister Kathleen may not have to have surgery. They're going to try to cure that tumor with radiation and chemo, so we're going to see how that, so that's a blessing. She's 8 years old, so.
Oh, good. We'll have to have surgery. Better than surgery. Okay. Good. Praise reports. Yep, Matthew, praise report. Jay's here. All right. Okay, praise the Lord for Matthew and Jay being here. More, yep, Ms. Chip.
My great granddaughter, they thought, you know, my Bible study's been praying for this, and they thought that she had some terrible urinary tract infection, and she was going to have a spinal tap and IV antibiotics and all that, and fine. And praise the Lord, after three tests, bless her heart, she is fine. And the first rule, look at your patient. And then my mother-in-law had hurt her back last week, and she had x-rays, and they said no fractures. But then they said CT scan, it said no fractures. Now they're doing an MRI, and I'm just, it's going to be no fractures. I hope no fractures.
All right. Praise the Lord for that. Yep.
Baby Cora turned 4 months old.
Yeah.
7 pounds.
Wow. She was 1 pound. Gotcha. Yep. We're praising the Lord for baby Cora, and she's still growing.
Yeah.
We're still praying for her situation. Mr. Hamilton.
Yeah, a lot of you know Sylvia Locke. She had a breast removed yesterday, and everything seemed to be doing real good. So we're praying for her.
We're praise the Lord for that.
Yeah.
And Mr. Hamilton chipped in on advice last week during the service, right? That was good. You don't even remember. I heard from the back row that you had some other advice, like, if there's no belly aching in heaven, what are we doing with all the women? That was funny. See, I don't know where I heard that from, but I can't believe you made it through the evening after that comment. And I promised I would not tell that you said that until I saw someone. So I kept the secret as long as I could.
I forgot. There was one more thing on my mother-in-law. They did those x-rays to look at her back, and they said no fractions. Well, then they called her a couple days later and said, come in and get more x-rays. We think you have pneumonia. Once again, absolutely no symptoms. And yes, she had more x-rays and no pneumonia.
Yep,
just keep trying.
All right. Very good. Okay, praise reports. Are we good with the praise reports? How about prayer requests? This is for Mr. Hamilton from his wife for making that comment.
Yeah.
During the service. It sounds like something Mr. Smith would say, honestly. Are there any? Yep, Ms. Erdl. Nathan, you said that, didn't you? Nathan. Okay, pray for Nathan with ALS. Yep. Okay. Matthew, you have a prayer request? Matthew's asking for prayer for his stomach issues and for his mom's salvation. Okay. Oh, Denise, sorry. Evening. We praise you for everybody that came out on a nice day, Lord God. We came here to worship together, to go deeper in anything that you have for us, Lord God. Right now we praise you for the way you're working, for the requests that we've been making. We praise you that even in Wyatt's situation, that you're still using his life and his testimony to even speak to his cousin, Lord God. We praise you for that. His cousin's starting to believe. Praise you, Lord God. Praise you for baby Cora. 7 pounds. Born at 1 pound, Lord God. We praise you. We still pray for her. Still lift her up before you, Lord God. Praise you for good test results, and this is Champ's family. We pray that you keep working there. Lord God, we just owe you everything. We're nothing without you. You give us our every single breath, Lord God. We praise you. We glorify you, Lord God. These requests, we lift them up to you tonight. We lay them at your feet. We know by your stripes we're healed, Lord God, so we lift up Chris before you. We lift up Kathleen, Mr. Zirkle's sister, before you, Lord God. We lift up people struggling, Lord God, with these illnesses. We lift them up before you. We ask for your healing. We're eager to give you the glory, Lord God. Tell the world how you heal and how you move and how you love, how you got us, not just short-term this life, but for eternity. You redeemed us with your blood. Praise you, Lord God. Death has no sting for us. We glorify and honor you, Lord God. You paid it all for us. We can walk through this world without any fear. Death has no sting. We praise you. We glorify you and honor you. Right now we lift up our worship to you. In Jesus' name, amen.
Amen.
You are.
You know, that's taking a stance. When you say, I'm giving it all, that's taking a stance. You know, a lot of people like to walk that line on both sides, you know? But God doesn't want us to walk that line. He wants us to pick one side. Take that side, you know? So giving it all means that you are declaring that He is your God. And that's what He wants. He wants us to declare the Lord our God is who He is to us and live it.
Promise.
Everybody looked at Christ on Christmas. Okay? Now we're coming up to Easter, so the whole world is kind of turning their gaze back on, you know? And you know what? I got to thinking that all those years ago when they crucified him, they put above him King of the Jews. They had no idea how powerful that was. They had no idea the prophecy they were saying. They had no idea that they were telling the truth. They were telling the gospel truth. You know, because he was king of their hearts. He is king of our hearts. He hasn't changed from that day to today. He's still the same. Everything he promised to the disciples, everything he promised to both the Jews and the Gentiles is still there for you. All you have to do is claim it. And when you claim it and you claim him as the king of your heart, just ask him to pour everything out all over you. Pour his spirit out of you into any crevice that you have. Cover you wholly, because then you'll have true life. Let the king of my heart be the mountain where I run, the fountain I drink from. Oh, he is my song. Let the king of my heart be the shadow where I hide, the ransom for my life. Oh, he is my song. Let the king of my heart be the mountain where I run, the fountain I drink from. Oh, he is my song. Let the king of my heart be the shadow where I hide, the ransom for my life. Oh, he is my song. You are good.
when the night is holding on to me, God is holding on. When the night is holding on to me, God is holding on. He is good.
Roll back that stone.
All we have to do is just ask.
and more. Jesus, you can have it all. Don't you pour your spirit out.
Spirit out among all of us, Lord, and we just pray that we take it with us, this feeling we have inside this, Lord, this energy that we feel, God. Let it be something that we share. Let it be something the world has to see because we can't contain it. And we just pray, God, for you to just continue to walk with us, continue to change history, God, continue to make the wrong things right in the ways that you want them to be, Lord. We just pray, Lord, that you continue to bless us. Keep us, Lord, your children, Lord, always in your path, always in your favor, always in your will. God, as we lead today and we go out among others who may not know you, help us to be the ones, Lord, that show you that you are the King. You are today, tomorrow, next week, always and forever, who you say you are and who you've always been. So God, we pray, Lord. We pray and we praise here tonight, Lord. And we just are willing and ready, Lord, to just accept anything that you have. So please, God, please continue to bless us tonight. Fill us with your word. Continue to have your spirit roam among us, Lord. Open holes, find places, fix cracks, Lord. Whatever needs mending, mend. Whatever needs healed, heal. Whatever needs for us to know, Lord, we pray, Lord, the job gets done tonight. And we thank you for all of that. And we walk with you tomorrow. In your name, Jesus, we pray. Amen.
It's okay. I don't need it tonight. Wah, 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 wah. Becky, you couldn't make it, could you? Couldn't make it downstairs, could you, Becky? No? Couldn't do it. Back row, huh? Back row. Hey, everybody, how we doing? Thought Becky and Jamie were going to get to sit downstairs, but she had milk of magnesia or something. Amnesia or anyhow. I don't know what I'm saying. Thanks a lot for coming. Thanks for coming to church. Glad you're here. Somebody's getting married, I heard. Somebody's back there getting married. Olivia's getting 22 is what she's getting, isn't it, right? She's getting 2-2? What? No. So, good stuff. And it was a sunshiny day today, right? Isn't that nice? Oh, that's so nice. Wasn't that so nice? Needed that so bad. Hey, we're glad you're here. I don't know what to share with you. I think they put some posts out on Chris. Did you guys see those posts? Third day, you know, he's had 5 days of radiation. This was the end of 3 straight days. I think he's probably feeling rough, and that's where he's at. So we did spend some time over the weekend with him, and he just said, tell the church we're fighting. He still had that same attitude. It doesn't matter which way it goes. He wins. So, but our hearts are just on it all the time. My heart's on it all the time. just brokenhearted about that whole thing. So, okay, what else do I want to share with you? Prayer for him, 5 o'clock Saturday, if you want to come out, over at LifeNet, not here, over LifeNet. And we'll just see if he's feeling good enough to come out or not. We don't believe that people have to be present. Do you believe that? Or you'd need, in your bed every night, when you're praying for people, you need them to come over. You know what I mean? So you believe that God can, right? You believe that God can move through. Yeah, no problem. What's bound on earth is bound in heaven, right? So regardless, we'd love to see him Saturday, but regardless, one way or the other, we're happy. Did you spill something again, Billy? That's like twice. That's like twice in 2 weeks, isn't it? You did the first time? Jody. So, okay, if you'd like to go to Peru with me, I'm taking off day after Easter. So some men are adding on here. So you can still add on and go. It'd be good if you want to go. You want to go? Matthew, I think we checked the list. We already have a Matthew. Thanks. All right. We got to get into it. Father, we thank you for time together. Lord, you're good. Thank you for that good music, talented people. We're grateful, Lord. We are blessed here. We are blessed with just that musical stuff that's really good. Lord, we thank you for everybody that serves in that. Thank you for the teachers. Lord, and with our kids, pray they don't kill them. Lord, for all your goodness, God, all your goodness. You're good, Lord. There are places in this world bombs are raining down. Lord, today you gave us this beautiful day, just a beautiful day. Lord, I pray that, Lord, wherever we are, whatever we're walking through, God, that you just meet us in that. You give us understanding. You give us just the confidence in you that you're good, that you know. Lord, from the beginning to the end, you were the beginning, you were the end. We believe, Lord, you've been to the end. We believe that you know the days, the hours, the weeks, the months of our life. You know the circumstance, you know the problems, you know our problems. You know, God, what you're doing, you know how to work, you know where you're at. God, you just know it all. We believe you're sovereign in all things, all-knowing. So, Lord, just give us the confidence we're walking in the middle of your hand. Lord, help us to walk according to plan. Meet us here tonight, Lord. Just got some time together, just good folks here at church, Lord. Just put something in us, Lord, we need. Speak to us in a way, God, we need. Let your word do what it's supposed to do, Lord. Whatever that is tonight, let it be accomplished in us, we pray. In Jesus' name, amen. Amen. We've been in Numbers. We've been in Numbers, and I guess we're in Numbers tonight. We're in Numbers 27, but I decided to read Numbers 27 to you out of Deuteronomy 31. Is that okay? Now you say, huh? You know that Deuteronomy is kind of a, okay, here's where we're at in the whole story. They leave Mount Sinai. Children of Israel leave Mount Sinai. They get up there to the promised land. They're the complainingest bunch of people you ever saw in your life, right? And we're learning here over a couple of weeks a couple of things about God on our journey to the promised land, right? One is God doesn't like complainers. Two is you better have faith and courage, because there's things God's going to ask you to do that's going to require faith and courage, right? So those are the main things, but they complain. There's a chapter in Numbers where, you know, Korah complains against Moses. Moses says, let's just show up at the tent of meeting, you know, let's just show up at the tabernacle and let's just see who God picks. And they show up that morning and all the people watching, and it's the first toilet flush. The ground opens up, boosh. But in that, what's crazy about it, if you read that, in that very same chapter, I think it says on the very next day, they complained again. And I get them all confused. He dropped fire at one point. He dropped a plague on them at one point. He dropped snakes on them at one point. Right? So the first slide here I have is they were rebellious. What was their rebellion? Well, they complained against a good God. Right? I think that hits all of us. Doesn't that hit all of us? Complaining against a good God. What do we got? The world's going to act worldly. The evil are going to act evilly, right? Evilly, is that a word? I mean, the prideful are going to be prideful. The godly are going to be. So, they complained they didn't get meat. Numbers 11. Aaron and Miriam spoke against Moses. They didn't like his wife. And they got those leprosy on them, you know. Woo! And you having a seizure? What? Easy, man, easy. Okay? So he doesn't like his wife. Drops leprosy on her, right? And that freaks her out a little bit. You think that, humbler, but there's something about human nature, right? And this is what's crazy, that whatever it is in us that is not what pleases God, and God's trying to work on, it's really easy for us to keep going back to that, right? It's really easy, you know? That's why, now listen to me, that's why when they do enter the promised land, we're not there yet, but when they do enter the promised land, the Lord says, kill all your enemies, just completely destroy your, because there shouldn't be anything to tempt you. So God wants you to cut stuff off. Cut things off, right? I could tell you a bunch of stories in my life where there were things that competed with God and things that I, and the Lord just said, nope, and I just had to quit. I just had to quit. Walk away. Don't go do that anymore. Don't be. They wouldn't. Some of those things in my life weren't sinful. That makes it. They were just things God wasn't gonna. I didn't have time for that. The Lord didn't want me doing it. Boom. Okay. So those they refused to enter the land of Canaan. Numbers 14. They had a failed attempt to try to enter later. Korah and Moses. I told you that people grumbled. Oh, they grumbled and said, Moses has caused all these people to die. And the Lord struck them again. People wanted water, and Moses got frustrated with them and hit the rock. Can I just tell you something? Maybe this is... Why is God so hard on us? And I learned this kind of through this Moses thing. What? Okay, we should know better. That's right. But you want to know why God's so hard? Because people are watching us. I prayed one time and said, Lord, why? Moses just hit the rock, man. There's a couple million people complaining. I'd hit the rock too. I said, God, why were you so harsh with Moses? You know, that's why Moses didn't go in. Why are you so harsh with Moses? And I felt like the answer was, because everybody was watching him. So sometimes you don't understand why God deals with you pretty harsh. But God's trying to break stuff out of you. God's trying to... And he'll do that. He'll do it. He'll do it. Right? He will do it. So they grumbled. They wanted to go back to Egypt. They did that the whole time. They began to commit harlotry with the women of Moab. So in this story, as the new generation comes around... They actually move up to the east side of land of Canaan. They defeat the Amorites and the Moabites. And while they're waiting on God there, these are the chapters we're in tonight, and God is speaking to Moses, and Moses is about to die, and Moses is trying to speak things over the people, and they're picking a new leader, Joshua. It's all in Numbers. They start messing around with the Moabite women. Now, what's wrong with you people? I hate to tell you that it's a type of us, right? It's the type of the believer. It's the type of... That we just... We pick up these little attitudes, you know? We pick up these certain things. God doesn't want any of that in our life. God doesn't want that. God doesn't want you, listen, if you're a Christian and you got a little attitude at work, God doesn't want that. That isn't what he wants. You want to bicker with people. God doesn't want that. I've learned, well, hard way. I had this lady, I haven't told this story for a while. I had this lady when I was a production manager and she was the quality manager. And she didn't like me. She just didn't like me. And that's easy for women to do. I have quite a few of those. But anyhow, she didn't like me. One day I stopped at a grave, picked up some flowers, and tucked them to her. Just trying to make peace. I've tried everything, anything. I wasn't going to buy flowers for her, but I was trying to. Anyhow, they didn't eat them anymore, and it was over. I never told her that. She had some rental properties. I'd go to her rental properties and try to work on her rental properties and just try to be anything. But she didn't like me. She didn't like me. She didn't like me. And I'd complain against her. I'd go to the boss and complain. She'd complain against me. And we were just in this back and forth, blah, 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 the wrestling thing. And the issue was I was trying to push production stuff through quality. You know what I mean? And she was trying to, because it was me trying to push stuff, she was trying to slow it down. The great thing was the bosses were usually on my side because they wanted stuff to ship. You know what I mean? So anyhow, they'd come down and say, what's her problem? And I'd say, she's got a problem against me. And the more I complained, the more worse it got. Flowers didn't help. And finally I said, Lord, is this really what you want me to do? At one point, I went to my boss and said, hey, me and her aren't getting along. It's starting to affect everybody. Starting to affect everybody in the whole thing. I don't want this. If you want me to quit, I'll quit. And he's like, no, we got to work this thing out. I didn't know. She had some protection. She was the girlfriend of the vice president of the company. She had some protection. And they said to me, no, we don't want you to quit, Mark. And I just started praying. I said, God, I'm at the point with her. Me or her's got to go, Lord. That's just what I think the wisdom. Lord, it's either me or her. So I went to the boss, said, I'll leave. I'll just go away. I don't want our issues to affect everybody in the whole. I don't want that. I don't want that anymore. I'm tired of that whole thing. When other people are talking about your interactions, it's like that's going to, you know, that's not. So I started saying, Lord, I'm messing up. God, I'm supposed to be this Christian. And I think this is all a test. And I'm not sure I'm passing this test. And I said, Lord, if you want me to leave. So I went to the boss, and the boss said, no, Mark, we want you to stay. I said, can she leave? Little did I know they were working on that. And I prayed, just changed my attitude and prayed. About 2 weeks later, they announced that vice president and his girlfriend were going to break off the company and go start their own business, and we're gone. I thought, Lord, if I'd just prayed 2 years ago. But I just want you, in what we're saying, I want you to evaluate how you're behaving, and everybody's watching. And are you complaining? Are people seeing stuff? You may not even have the intent to be a bad testimony, but listen, for so many people that are watching you, all you got as a witness is often who you are. That makes sense? And, you know, my Bible says when I do things, I'm to do it unto the Lord. So I've just got to do it. I learned, hey, whether it's working or it's not working, I need to be the first guy there. I need to be the hardest worker. I need to be the most positive. And I'm telling you, that led to a lot of promotion in my life. My flesh wanted to be just the opposite. You know, I bet you can't believe this, but there's days I stand on this stage and there's some people I don't even like. There's times I stand on this stage, my belly's just rolling, you know what I mean? I'm like, oh, I got to find a bathroom after this, you know what I mean? There's times I get up here, man, I don't feel so good. I got up here a couple weeks ago with, I'd had a tooth pulled and my mouth was hurting, you know what I mean? And I'm not I try not to be a wimp. I just try to, Lord, that's my job. I'll just do my job. But I try to come and just be as positive, you know, as I can be. Lord, I'm not complaining. I don't want to complain, especially in this series, because I'm kind of taking this start, because I'm really a good complainer. I think you could put me on the professional complaining level. The Lord sent me to Haiti twice because I complained. I think I've tried to be strong, and I think I've tried to have courage in the things the Lord's asked me to do. We're trying to do things with great courage. But when it gets tough, it affects my person. I'm supposed to be a light to a world. I'm supposed to be set apart for a God thing, right? Every time I hear, that whole sanctification thing, it's a process God's trying to work on us our whole life. He's trying to set us apart. Listen, there's the world, and then we're not better than anybody, but God sets us apart for His business. So I'm in this world where we got all the world business, but God set me apart for His business. Now, I think that's great. I think that's amazing that the God of heaven, and maybe you don't know the God I know, but the God that created the stars and the moon and the sun, you know, that knows the numbers of days, knows the hairs of my head, knows all that stuff, He called me and set me apart, and I think that's pretty special, you know what I mean? And I'm supposed to be this witness. So I can't let the stuff in this world work me back into my flesh, work me back into my... And I think, because I'm such a good complainer, I think that's where the enemy wants to take me every time. Right? So, they go through this stuff. What's God do? What I need to see from this list here is God smacked them down every time they did it. You know what I mean? I'm like, oh! So, I'm this big teacher. We live in grace. God doesn't smack me down right away. But someday I'll stand before Him and He'll say, what's your problem, dude? I'm challenged about my own sin in terms of what God's working on me about. Hey, with the line, David chased Bathsheba. And the prophet says to David, I pulled you up out of the shepherd's field. And I was with you in every battle. I protected you from King Saul. I rose you up through the ranks to be the king of this nation. And then the thing that cuts me like a knife is, and if you'd have needed anything else, I'd have gave it to you. And you go off and do that. And I think that just plows into me. Lord, you've been so good to me. You've helped me here and here and here and here. And I've got a mouth that complains. Or I've got someplace my brain goes, you know, it happens to all different things. Or someplace this thing. Or I get in a negative spirit. Or I start. I have a feeling that if I wasn't under grace, lightning would have hit me a few times already, right? Or snakes would have fell, or fire, or something would have. But God has been gracious to us all, right? But God just wants us to grow. God wants us to be challenged by His Word. We're on a journey. Hey, our final destination isn't this hard place we're in right now. You know what I mean? It isn't in the pain that we have in our body right now. It's not in that at all. It isn't the circumstance we find at work right now. No. We have an eternal home in the heavens, not made by human hands, right? Right? But we get caught in this. We lose sight of the big for the little. And that's what they're doing. God is giving them, I'll give you that land. Hornets will run them all. You're in it. You don't even have to fight. You walk right in it and eat the grapes. I already got growing up. They'll have the houses built. Hey, the wells dug. The bed's made, you know what I mean? You guys didn't bring, I'm just going to give it to you, you know what I mean? The kitchen cupboards, the automobiles, the cell phones, they'll have it all. And you're going to walk in, and I'm going to give it to you. Because when I get to heaven, I'm expecting, hey, the bed will be made. The well will be drilled. It'll be glorious. Right? And God wants to give me that. And along this journey, I'll complain about. It's really good for you. I don't know if you understand. It's really good for you to be like the Apostle Paul. It's good for you to have a season in your life where you don't have nothing. You know, that makes sense. It's really good to be in want. It's good to be in plenty. You know what I mean? It's good to be in a tough spot. It's good to be in a good spot. You know what I mean? So God gets you kind of understanding that whatever state you're in, thank God for it. Right? Thank God for it. So at some point, We're preaching in Numbers, right? At some point, the story gets retold to them, to the new generation in Deuteronomy. Did everybody get that? So Deuteronomy has some repeat in it. So I can catch up in Deuteronomy, hey, and find Numbers 27, basically. So we're going to be in Numbers 27, but we're going to tell it to you out of Deuteronomy 31. Is that okay? Now, I know the verses in Deuteronomy 28, 29. Hey, If you'll do the right thing, God will bless you in your lands, and God will bless you in your families, and God will bless you in your homes, and God will bless you in your cattle, and God will bless you. You know, if you do the wrong thing, God will curse you in your home, and God will curse you, and your enemies will rise up against you. You know what I mean? And it's kind of, you know, that's kind of the law of God, that everything we do has a blessing or a curse. Everything has an equal, how do they say it? Equal outcome. What you sow, you reap it. And you can't control every circumstance in your life, but I'm telling you, by the end of your days, hey, you've had the ability to control enough stuff that where you're at, hey, is a result of what you sowed. Does that make sense? Okay. So those are the things that happened to them. We're in Deuteronomy 31, and Moses went and spoke these words to all Israel. Now Moses is getting at the end of his life. They've already defeated the Amorites and the Moabites. They're looking. They can almost look across the Jordan and see. They can certainly go up in the hills. And in fact, Moses ends up doing that. He goes up in the hill and he dies in the hills, actually. And I don't know if you know this, but Jude said, and they never found his body. The book of Jude said that the devil fought over, but they didn't want to find Moses' body because they were afraid those crazy would worship him, put him on a stick and worship him or something. I don't know. But so in Jude we find out the devil wrestled for his body. It's kind of weird, but and Moses went and spoke these words. So what's Moses trying to do? Does anybody know what is Moses the man? Hey, was he perfect? No. But was he the man? He was the man God called. They were so dumb. I shouldn't say the word dumb. They were so dumb to be against the man that God called. You deal with men, you know what I mean? Hey, and you deal with dumb men. But be careful about the men that God calls. You know, be careful for people having an anointing in a certain particular area, and then God uses them in that area. Listen, just walk in the blessings of God, you know what I mean? Support the things that are, you know, that are of God, you know? So Moses is the man, hey, and I believe this with all my heart. The older we get as men, now, the more powerful our words become. Joe Ford would come in here, and everybody listened, right? I know this as a dad. Hey. More time goes on, the more my kids, hey, they don't, small talk, blah, blah, blah. Mom does that all the time. That's why mom isn't in the same, mom's back and forth with kids all the time. And yeah. But dad, hey, Moses is in that position. We had some troubles, but God was with us through it all, right? we've had our deals. God moved through us all, you know. And there's just a respect for him here. So Moses gets an opportunity to speak some things. In fact, in chapter 32, he writes a song. And they say, before you die, Moses, in fact, it says on the same day, he writes this song, before you die, teach it to your people, hey, so that your people might sing the song, hey, they might know your heart and know God's heart over them. So 32 is a song that Moses writes, and he wanted them to teach it to their children so that all the generations would know the heart of Moses. Interesting stuff. And he said to them, I am 120 years old today. So I guess we've got to sing birthday to Moses, 120. So on the very day he's doing this, he's 120. And I can no longer go out or come in. I don't know if they had wheelchairs invented yet or not. I don't know. But, hey, he's basically saying, I've come to the end of my days, right? Also, the Lord has said to me, you shall not cross over this Jordan. And the Lord, your God himself, will cross over before you, and he will destroy these nations from before you, and you shall depossess them, meaning you're gonna get rid of them, and you're gonna get rid of their lifestyle, and you're gonna come and conquer, but you're not gonna take anything they got. You're gonna push away from who they are. It's kind of a neat word there, dispossess. How often do you see that? Right? Joshua himself crosses over before you. Joshua will cross over before you, just as the Lord had said. And the Lord will do to them as he did to that guy and that guy, who were the kings of the Amorites. So they'd already defeated the Amorites and the Moabites and their land. And he, when he destroys them. So the Lord is already telling them, hey, no, that's not true. Moses is telling them, hey, what you see and thought the Lord already do with the Amorites and Moabites, he's going to do it with them. Now, does that not mean we don't have to fight any battles? I think they blew that the first time. So they got some battles to fight. But what's the promise spoken over them already? He'll go before them. He's going to go over, you know? Hey, and you're going to have the thing that God promised you. Right? And the Lord will give them over to you that you may do to them according to every commandment which I have commanded you. So, what's that saying? I just want to say, yeah, and oh yeah. Right? The Lord said, and yeah. That's what I want, you know. Be strong and be of good courage. Uh-oh. Now, a lot of people read that and say, man, that's such a powerful... When I read that, I go, I'm not trying to be disrespectful. Oh, crap. Guess why? Because it's going to take some strength and some courage to do. That means we're not flying in a magic carpet. You know what I mean? We're not going in a magic carpet and the parking meter's already paid. You know, it's not none of that. It's we're going in there and it's going to be tough. Ask some Ukrainian Christians right now. I bet some of them, I bet there were prophetic words. Hey, I don't mean this bad, but I bet there were prophetic words in the churches saying, the Lord's going to drop this nation. There's so much corruption in Ukraine. Hey, I bet there are prophetic words in the church that said, the Lord's going to drop this nation, but God will be with us who trust in him. You know what I mean? And they're in it right now, the Ukrainian Christian man. And Derek was just over there, and he says the church is lovely and beautiful. We got pictures on our refrigerator of Derek and Steph holding Ukrainian flags. They were just there recently. Talked about how beautiful the church is. There's moments in this life where proud. Can I talk? I get in trouble sometimes when I talk family. My son back there, I got two sitting back there. One back there, and he made it through architecture school. Hey, with a wife, with a family, loading trucks at UPS at 4 o'clock in the morning, staying up all night trying to do these models and projects and stuff. Hey, be of good courage, son. You're there. Just don't. I think the story goes like this, he can correct, but they only took like 20 students into the School of Architecture every semester. And to make it in was a great honor. And he always said he wasn't the number one. He was probably 19th or someplace in there, but they took him in. And that's such a major accomplishment. We thought that was so great. And in the moment he'd accomplished something, the work got real hard, and it got real long, and it got real heavy, and it got real hard. One thing I know about Charlie is there was a lot of bad moments. Ask Chandra, she'll know, she'll tell you. But he pressed through it. And there's something about this Christian walk that says you got to be an overcomer, right? Overcomers will sit on the throne. As I have overcome, that's what he says, you know. Jesus says, as I have overcome, hey, as you overcome, you're going to sit in the throne here with me for a little bit. You know what I mean? Now, not very long, because he's the king and you're just the, but there's something about this life where every one of us are going to have to overcome something or some things. So when he says to him, be strong and be of good courage, it's like, oh. Don't fear nor be afraid of them. What's he saying to him? You've got an enemy. Why are you afraid of them? For the Lord your God, he is the one who goes with you. Okay, let me do this again. I'm not scolding you. I'm just, in the Pentecostal church I grew up in, they'd be shouting hallelujah right there. I'm just telling you. Anytime you told my Pentecostal church I grew up in that the Lord would go with you, they'd be like, yeah! Oh yeah, that makes the world of difference to me. And he will not leave you nor forsake you. He'll go with you. Now, do you believe that for you? So to get there, you're going to have to be strong, have courage, right? Not be afraid. Because he'll go with me. He ain't quitting me. These are Moses' words. Then Moses called Joshua and said to them, in the sight of all Israel, be strong and of good courage. You must go with these people to the land which the Lord has sworn to your fathers to give them, and you shall cause them to inherit it. So Joshua, you're going to lead this. I don't care. I don't care who you, if you're a Christian, God's given you something to lead. I'm just telling you. Or let me do it this way. If you're not there yet, he's preparing you for a moment ahead where you'll bleed. Right? He's trying to develop. I do this thing, 26 things that my father should have taught me. One of those things is, hey, to be a winner, you got to develop the characteristics of a leader. And he is the one who goes before you, and he will be with you, and he will not leave you nor forsake you. Do not fear nor be dismayed. And again I go, oh, heck. If he's telling me that strong, that means I'm going to think at some point he isn't with me. You know what I mean? I'm going to think he's forsaken me. I'm going to think, oh, all is lost. What's What's or be dismayed? Does anybody know what or be dismayed mean? Do not fear or be dismayed. What's dismayed? We don't say dismayed. Do you ever say, hey, are you what? Discouraged. I think we need to say it that way because we know what discouraged is. We don't know what dismayed is. That's like not the month of May. Dismay. Duh. Dismayed, duh. Yeah. So Moses wrote the law and delivered it to the priest, and the son of Levi bore the ark of the covenant of the Lord and the elders of Israel. And Moses commanded them, saying, at the end of every 7 years, at a point in time, we put those verses in there. We are going to skip down to 13, I think. So there's a pretty cool thing there that has to do with a millennium. And if I had time, I'd teach it. But they had to go up, hey, they had to go every 7 years to the house of the Lord on the Feast of Tabernacles. Hey, and the Lord would meet them there, you know what I mean? And in the millennium, they have to go every year on the Feast of Tabernacles to the house. Anyhow, it's a millennium thing. Okay, so next verse. The Lord said to Moses, behold, the days are approaching when you must die. That's a bummer. Call Joshua and present yourself in the tabernacle meeting that I may inaugurate him. So Moses and Joshua went and presented themselves at the tabernacle. There was a moment where, hey, Joshua, listen, 40 years before, Joshua behaved like a leader. And he tried, I think he tried, him and Caleb tried their best. No, don't reject the Lord. The Lord's going to give us that land. What are you doing? What are you thinking? The other 10 were like, nope. How's it go? I'm trying to think. Joshua's out there going, he'll give us that land. They're behind him. They're going. Now, let me just say this. The thing we miss in the scriptures is how long it takes God to do what God does, right? So you think, hey, you know, 5 minutes later, Joshua is the president. You know what I mean? No. 40 years later. But you know when Joshua started behaving? It's interesting. He must have behaved like a leader before that because he was chosen as a representative of a tribe. You know what I mean? So he must have been behaving for a... So you know what he realized was God's trying to develop the characteristics in all of us as a lead, as a leader. So they went, like the Lord said. The Lord appeared in the tabernacle in a pillar of a cloud, and a pillar of a cloud stood before the door of the tabernacle. And the Lord said to Moses, behold, you will rest with your fathers, and this people will rise and play the harlot with the gods of the foreigners in the land. Uh-oh. You think, hey, it's inauguration day. Hey, here's your new... No, Moses stands up and he says, no, the Lord says to Moses, hey, Moses, you're out of here. You know what these people are going to do? They're going to start sinning against me. And there's a big portion here where basically it comes down to, you guys were sinning with me around. What are you going to do when I'm gone? Right? Now, I've walked into enough rooms and had people straighten up real quick. You ever had that? You ever walk in another room? It's so funny. And now, don't take this wrong. Don't take this wrong. You don't know how many times. Usually after church, I stay in here. You know, I'm staying here. You know what I mean? Staying here and talk to people and stuff. But occasionally, somebody got out the door, and I need to go catch them. And I'll run out in the parking lot real quick. It's so funny how many smokers. Pastor came outside, man. You talk about dropping cigarettes. The fast thing drop, man. There's like, ooh. I've had to tell people before, listen, you smoke before the Lord. Don't worry about me. I'm nothing. I can't tell you how many times I went out there in the parking lot, tall and go, nice day, huh? And it's that whole idea of, if you're messing up when the leader was around, listen, you got to listen. There's something here. Hey, if God's put somebody in your life to pour into you, hey, and you're trying to fool them, when they're no longer there, guess what you'll be doing? You better respond to leadership correctly, right? Because true loving leaders, true Christian leaders are really just trying to get the best out of you. They're really, trying to pick you, trying to teach you, trying to develop you, trying to. Right? You better respect people that have some voice into your life because God put them there. You can say in your heart, I ain't listening to that. That's stupid. That's old-fashioned. That's this way. That's that way. Okay. If you're going to act like that when the leader's around. And he tells them in advance, I'm going to be gone. You guys are going to start sinning. They'd already been sinning with the Moabite women. God had to deal with that. I think, and I didn't clearly look at it, but I think he drops a plague on them. And if the darn priest didn't step up to do something, I tell you that the priest threw a harpoon, threw a spear, threw a man and a Moabite woman. And kills them, and stands between the plague and the other people, and God stops the plague, or he'd have killed all of them. That's where they got that idea for the Halloween movie. And never mind. And my anger shall be aroused against them in that day. They're going to mess around, and I'm going to get mad. Give me that next one here. Okay, give me the next one. There's a funny one here. Okay, give me the next one. Give me the next one. My anger will be aroused. I thought that was a good picture. And you ain't gonna like me when I'm angry. And it says, and many evils and troubles shall befall them, so that they will say in that day, has not these evils come upon us because our God is not among us? Now, I don't know how you take that. Either here they have a recognition that we're in trouble because we didn't invite God in, or they're saying this all happened to us because God quit us. God quit us. Basically blaming God. There's two ways you can interpret that. Time's running out here. You know what happens? Moses writes a song. He teaches them a song. He goes up on Mount Nebo and he never comes back. Next week we'll pick up in Joshua, right? Father, we thank you for time together. There were things in that, Lord, I don't normally talk about. So, Lord, pray we had ears to hear, because there was something new, Lord, that needed to be said there. Speak to people, Lord. Develop Christian character and the character of being the leader that you have appointed us to be. You called us out of darkness that we might lead people to know you. Thank you, Lord, for all those things. We love and praise you in Jesus' name. Amen. Thanks for coming now. Come back. Come back.